The relationship between the WWE and its fans has always been a pretty strange one. For the longest time now, we've been hearing Vince and his respective mouthpieces all tell us that the WWE universe is a force akin to, I don't know,
a nuclear bomb able to change the world with its sheer power of will.
However, these messages are also delivered alongside blatant lies, booking that goes in spite of what is both logical and crowd-pleasing, and there is a constant soundtrack of quotes and quips that attempt to brainwash us week in and week out. And you know what? Why should we stand for that? The answer is, you shouldn't. So instead of buying another Sonic Burger or whatever piece of Tat Vince's sweat shack of back attacks wants you to, let's look behind the curtain at the real face of the business and say, enough is enough, you cheeky whippet. And if you need a reminder of where to point the fingers, well, I'm here with a list to help, because I'm Jules, this is WhatCulture.com, and these are 7 times the WWE sold out its fans. Number 7. The dream match that never happened. In 1991, the then wrestling equivalent of hell freezing over had finally become a reality as Rick, the limousine riding, jet flying, hair dying, sorry if I'm prying, always trying and never buying, don't set an alarm because I'm having a lion, Ric Flair had arrived in the WWF with the big gold belt still wrapped around his strutting waist. And remember, this is in the days where news permeating via the internet was not a thing, and so a moment such as this caused fans to have a meltdown of delirium. Every single person who knew of the existence of wrestling had only one thing on their minds. The clash of the ages, the greatest men in the world standing in the same ring, the biggest match in pro wrestling history, Ric Flair versus Hulk Hogan. The story booked itself. And so, of course, the WWE never gave it to us. Instead, in a very early prelude to WrestleMania's current mantra of more matches, please, they replaced it with a double main event. Groan. We got Flair battling Randy Savage and a rare sighting of Shane O'Mac not leaping off things for his father's love, and also a match with Hogan versus Sid Justice, where the ending got botched because Papa Shango couldn't hoof it to the ring in time. Fans were left completely bewildered by this apparent lack of want to cash in on a money match, and were left reeling when the WWE stated further down the line that the reason they didn't pursue the angle was because house show matches between the two weren't all that over with the audience. Absolute bollocks, if you ask me. This was a match that fans desperately wanted, and the WWE simply refused. Number 6. Reinstating Hulk Hogan. Now, flash forward to the modern era of wrestling, and weirdly, not much has changed. In fact, the underlying nuance for this one is far, far worse. So, as we all may remember, back in 2015, we saw quite possibly the biggest forced disappearance in WWE history, as Hulk Hogan was Thanos'd away from all of the record and history books. The Gawker tape scandal was one of the ugliest moments in pro wrestling, where one of its quintessential greats was shown using a horrible racist slur in a derogatory context against African-American individuals. The public responded in outrage and demanded Hulk be held accountable, and he was, for a time at least, as in 2018, Real American resonated through the WWE's arenas once more. The return felt like a desperate push by the company to sweep everything under the rug as quickly as possible, but this meant that corners were cut, and many of the locker room have stated that there was never a proper apology nor an admission of guilt, and that Hogan's attempts at addressing the black members of the roster, as later pointed out by Big E, were less than satisfactory. The crowd reactions greeting him upon his return were mixed, to say the least. People didn't know whether to applaud or boo, and most just looked on perplexed. For a company that supposedly prided itself on inclusivity, while at the same time ushering back in the Hulkster after this outburst, was a kick in the teeth for fans, and it felt like an old boys club more than ever before, basically showing that the company was willing to let pretty much anything slide in order to make a buck. Number 5. Hulkamania returns to bury Bret Hart. Jesus, Hogan, stop hogging this bloody list. Okay, one more time for the big bolster. This time, we're talking about WrestleMania 9, and instead of trying to get over racism, he's trying to get himself over, which he absolutely loved to do. Now, the problem was that he was trying to reignite this run just as the new generation era was getting ready to take off. At Mania 9, Hulk Hogan returned to snag the belt off Bret in a move that completely buckled the audience's love for the man. At this point, Bret Hart had quickly risen through the ranks and became the new fan favourite. He was a pure babyface with a ton of technical skill and even had a monstrous foreign heel to overcome, which would have cemented his legacy in the company and with the fans. And so, after seeing the crowd in meltdown after denying Bret the chance to capture the belt, Vince decided it was then time to shove Hogan back into the spotlight, restoring a boring status quo in an incredibly cheap way and crushing Hart's main event push. The ending to the event was also one of the worst screwy finishes, as Hart was beaten by the most destructive weapon ever to be made in Japan, according to the WWE, the dreaded salt. Then, inexplicably, Hogan arrived, Mr. Fuji challenged him to a title match, because why not, and then the match was over quicker than a Zack Ryder push. Nobody wanted Hogan as their world champion, but that's what you get for being a WWE fan sometimes. Number 4. The Billy and Chuck Wedding. Here we have another unsavory example of the WWE failing to understand inclusivity, and it's an angle that actually gets brought up a lot by fans as a completely wasted moment for the company and one that puts incredibly sour taste in the mouths of fans. The story had so much potential to promote something incredibly relevant at a time when systemic marginalization was still very much a thing. But as this is the WWE, that is not what we ended up getting. Instead, before tying the knot, both revealed the entire love angle had been a lie, which, well, besides being incredibly insulting, was incredibly depressing, offering little compromise other than, lol, we did it for the bants, before ending in a schmoz, which is the only way that they could get the crowd to move on from this awkward, awkward moment. For gay members of the audience and those watching at home who wanted to believe that their favorite entertainment brand was standing up for them, this was a truly shocking and sobering moment. Number 3. Batista wins the 2014 Royal Rumble. Yes, okay, I know that this actually didn't matter in the end, as the fans carried Daniel Bryan into the main event of WrestleMania anyway, despite the WWE's refusal towards the Yes Man, but it all started with one of the worst fan backlashes ever at the year's Royal Rumble. Big Dave had made his return and rode the wave of momentum and backstage support to punch his ticket for a main event showdown with Randy Orton. However, there was just one tiny thing standing in his way. The entire WWE universe. The sheer fury pouring out from the fans when Daniel Bryan didn't even appear in the Rumble was otherworldly. This was a man chosen by the people to reach the top, and even locker rooms from other promotions began to shout out in praise of the man who simply wasn't being given a fair shake. In the end, mountains were moved, the sky torn down, CM Punk walked out, before finally the people's champion had become WWE's champion, and no, I'm not talking about The Rock. Despite all that, however, nothing can erase the memory of this night and how hard the WWE shortchanged its fans. Number 2. Twice in a Lifetime. Ah, everyone loves this angle, don't they? Well, they love to dump on it, that is. 2011 marked the beginning of CM Punk's ascendancy as the voice of the voiceless, the master of the pipe bomb, and dare we say it, become the best in the world. Later in the year, he would begin the iconic 434-day WWE title run, which slowly built steam to the point that people were feverishly questioning who was going to be the talent to come in and finally end it. Perhaps it would be used to put over the next big thing. Perhaps it couldn't be done. Perhaps Punk would leave with his belt on his terms and... oh wait, no, it's The Rock. Now don't get me wrong, I love Dwayne, but the way that The Rock was inserted into this angle wasn't even for Punk's benefit. It was for John Cena, who only wanted to avenge his loss in the previous year's Mania event. And so, almost with a whimper rather than with a bang, Punk dropped the championship to Rocky because Vince wasn't interested in his chew toy anymore now that the big bollocks were swinging at each other. For both the straight-edge savior and his legions of fans, it was another classic case of WWE stubbornly sticking to who they believed should be the biggest stars, as opposed to actually listening to their audience. And number 1, Muhammad Hassan. Oh dear lord, where do we even begin with this one? As we all know, the early 2000s were a turbulent time for the entire world. Post 9/11, the very face of geopolitics had changed with the rising threat of extremism creating panic and discord. And one of the most unfortunate consequences of it, in fact it's actually one that still reverberates in the modern day, was the rise of fear-mongering and animosity towards Muslims in general. Something that people on both sides of the breach took advantage of to further their own agendas while continuing to hurt the innocent. So where do you think the WWE fell on this? Say hello to Muhammad Hassan, a gimmick that was so abhorrently terrible it still draws amazement as to how a multinational billion-dollar company could have ever approved it. To begin with, Hassan's character focused on calling out the audience for hating Muslims, something which was a genuine, legitimate issue at the time, and yet the WWE portrayed him as a bad guy. As he continued to spread his brand of, well, asking people to not be dicks to Muslims and grrr, how dare he, it all culminated in a moment which remains the absolute antithesis of what good entertainment should be. Hassan prayed and summoned a bunch of goons dressed in terrorist-like gear who carried off the Undertaker. The character got binned off immediately after this, although apparently that only happened because of the London bombings that happened as well. For the WWE's Muslim fan base, you had just seen the show that you love and that you admire openly mock the sufferings of your people and then paint someone talking about it as both bad and having the power to magically create terrorists. Thanks, Vince. Thanks a lot. And there we go. Those were seven times the WWE sold out its fans. I hope that you enjoyed that, my friends, as best you could, because we dealt with some very horrible topics today. But just remember, out of all of this, you can vote with something that the WWE will actually listen to, your bloody wallet. I hope that you have a fantastic day, whatever you are getting up to, my friends, because you, yes, you listening at home, deserve love, happiness, and success. We all do. And if there's one thing that we can take from this list, it is not to hate and move forward together. So I hope that you're treating yourself fairly, both physically and mentally, as best you can. And remember, if you need help, there is no shame in asking for it, because people out there care way more than you might realize. As always, I've been Jules, and go follow me at RetroJ with a zero over on Twitter. If you want to check out something completely different to wrestling, then I actually run a board game channel here called Live and Let's Dice. And it's always just a bit of fun playing board games outside of the office. I hope that you have a fantastic day, because remember, as always, you have been awesome. Never forget that, and I'll speak to you soon.